Yeah, very nice. Hi, Julien. We just know each other from emails. Right now, we kind of see each other. Thanks for the talk. There have been some quite interesting points being mentioned about remittance payment infrastructure in general, but also regarding the current status of Libra. Maybe we start with some interesting questions where I thought a lot of with other people, by the way. What do you think is Libra's competitors potentially doing? You know, what about Apple, Google, other companies out there, Amazon, are they also developing such projects? Because very often people ask, why has it been Facebook initiating Libra at that time? Why not Apple and why not Google? Maybe it's an artifact, right? Can be. Maybe it was strategy. Maybe other companies are developing more in the background and we just don't see it. What's your opinion there?
Yeah, that's a good question, Philipp. So I think competition is coming. However, it is the difficulty is you have to set things so that it is worldwide adoption. And I think some of the solutions that we currently have, they really have gone out with maybe not as much stakeholder engagement as we have tried to have over the past 12, 16 months. But it was clear, for example, a Visa several months ago announced a large investment in a digital payments space, PayPal, I mentioned in my opening remarks. Apple was interesting the way, since you mentioned them, I will talk about it. Apple essentially decided with their Apple Pay to partner up with Goldman Sachs to offer their own version of a payment system through Apple Pay. I could absolutely foresee other tech firms that get into the space. But at the end of the day, the biggest differentiator that we have here is around interoperability. If you take a current look at the way the financial system works, they operate in real silos. So we have great efficiencies. For example, in Europe, there is the payments directive, where it is very easy to make a payment from one bank account to another bank account. However, we still have that international payment solution that needs to exist. And so I think the nuance here and the difference is the interoperability that we have with our open source course on GitHub. You would be able to essentially send one another or pay for certain things in an interoperable way, which today is just not the case. So I don't think, again, with 1,600 cryptocurrencies that are around, I think there are many, many that are trying to get things right. But I think the differentiator here for tech companies should be the interoperability.
Okay, I think this is interesting. It also relates to another question because interoperability is key. And if we are paying, for example, with Apple Pay, you can pay now in Germany at every second restaurant, vending machines, ticket machines, using Apple Pay for purchasing your ticket, voucher, espresso, pizza, and so on, which is fascinating, right? Sometimes I discover asking myself, actually, why do I need blockchain for this? Because I myself talk about machine economy and IoT payments and so on. And then you have to really reflect on yourself saying, why do we need blockchain? Because it does work already, right? So I know that that of course Apple Pay is not costless, right? It's dramatically expensive for the vendors and so on. But what would be your reply on critics, on very fundamental criticisms like this, saying why should we need Libra? Because we have Apple Pay now, and Corona and so on showed us that it does work for millions of people.
Yeah, that's a good question. So it works for millions of people, not billions of people. And I think the crux of this, Philipp, is that we are in a world today where 3 billion individuals don't have or have poor access to the modern financial system. And that is a big number. And I think thinking outside of the box, you and me, we currently have plenty of options for payments. You just mentioned the Apple Pay as being one of them that still rides on traditional payment rails. These traditional rails have been around for really 30, 40 years. They've been unchanged. In fact, the parallel that I would draw here, Philipp, is if you remember the telecoms just 30 years ago, I remember calling back my grandparents when I was studying in the United States as a young kid when I went to school there. I remember that my mom would tell me, listen, call on Saturdays because instead of costing a couple euros a minute, it will cost a little less, maybe 1 euro back in the day. Of course, I was in the US, so it was dollars. But if you inflation adjust what it used to cost back then to do an international phone call between France and the United States or vice versa, it's approximately 6 euros today. And so today, we can have this wonderful conference, me sitting in my living room in Switzerland and you in Frankfurt. And it is essentially costing us nothing. So we've seen progress in telecoms, but remittances, for example, we have not seen progress. And this interoperability and optionality is just one more way for individuals to join the modern financial system. And at the end, it really is, Philip, a consumer choice. As a consumer, I choose to walk around with my phone. And whenever they have a way for me to pay without touching cash, that is my choice. Although I always keep a check in my wallet, as well as two different credit cards. Again, because sometimes you can pay with one or not the other. And again, an additional option that is on digital rails, I think should be offered to consumers.
Yeah, that's a good point. And now, of course, I have to be a little bit critical because Libra has been delayed a little bit because you had some headwind, right, from regulatory bodies, which is fair enough. Of course, they seek to protect existing infrastructure, which is absolutely fine. People around the world, central banks around the world, called Libra being a wake-up call, right? How does it feel? Being a wake-up call around the world for all kinds of governments, ministries, central banks, regulators, and so on, because you know this, you basically kind of changed the world. Because since Libra in July 2019, that's a little bit more than 1 year ago, since that time, the topic of CBDC really gained momentum, even though it was exactly the same topic previously to July. You know, the topic did not change, the technology did not change. I had exactly the same PowerPoint slides before Libra 1 and after Libra 1, but suddenly people listened and suddenly people got interested. So that was basically triggered by Libra. How does it feel being the wake-up call, right?
Well, thank you for the question, Philip. I could tell you that I have a lot more gray hairs than I did last year when I started with Libra. I have a lot more bruising and I've gained a lot of weight. So how does it feel? I don't feel super great about it physically. But I think what we've done is, you know, we've made significant efforts to collaborate with stakeholders around the world. And the one clear message that I have is that innovation doesn't have to be at odds with regulation. And I think initially when the project was launched, quite aspirational, a lot of individuals saw that innovation could be a threat. And I think we've had this throughout history. An example I have is one of your colleagues earlier this morning spoke about a very large banknotes, special banknotes that used to exist in the United States. And in the US, for example, they started printing in the late 1800s a bill of $10,000. And this bill was used until the end of World War II. So you could essentially have a $10,000 bill, which back in the day, again, with inflation adjusted, you would be looking at over $100,000 bill today. And in the late 60s, I believe it's 1969, and my friend Franklin Knoll is a great historian, and I believe he is participating today, so he could correct me. But in 1969, they took the bill out of circulation in the United States, and they asked the Federal Reserve, why they decided to take the banknote out of circulation. And their response was because they thought that checks and credit cards would only be the future, and that needing a $10,000 note as well as cash would not be needed in the future. So here we are 50 years later since we had introduced charge cards and credit cards. And today, yet again, you have a large part of the world, global transactions, about 70% are settled in cash even today. So I think yet again, you know, the discussion, you're absolutely right, was around many years ago. You, Philipp, has been covering it for years. The difference here, I think, was, again, the open platform and the ability to have individuals interact with one another based on a digital payment like a Libra coin.
Yeah, sounds good. And another topic would be, again, touching interoperability, but from another perspective, because Libra seeks to be a permissioned network, right? Mainly as a payment rails for existing currencies, potentially also for other assets, right? But it's restricted. Not everybody can deploy his or her smart contracts there. Basically, it's a curated system. At some point of time, you might have smart contracts there, but it's not basically freely opened up, right? So it's a limited system in the beginning. That's how it was scoped. Because this way you, of course, want to keep the transaction throughput possible. But you have Ethereum, which potentially can also handle a higher transaction throughput in the future. Plus, it's entirely free. Everybody can upload his or her smart contract there and tokenize all kinds of assets there. Then you have Stellar also being able to have a higher transaction throughput, also tokenizing all kinds of things on this platform. Then you have other Ethereum killers, which are out there since a couple of years, but most of them having a quite small community. And of course, you have Bitcoin being something like digital gold, most probably. So how do you think Libra is fitting in basic? Not these crypto assets. That's not what I wanted to talk about. But how is Libra fitting in this array of smart contract platform? Because they all want to be payment rails, right? Or asset transfer platforms. How is Libra fitting in here? And who of the named projects is actually complementary, which I would expect Bitcoin to be, and which would be competitive? I would expect Stellar, for example, to be not necessary anymore when Libra is there, right? How do you see Libra positioned in terms of being complementary or competitive in the area of the top five, top seven platforms?
Yeah, so the Libra Association deals with institutional counterparties. The one kind of clarifying point I'll make, Philipp, in what you said, which was totally accurate, is really the ecosystem any individual can build on the Libra blockchain. Now, because this ecosystem will also have regulated virtual asset service providers or digital wallet providers, as you're well aware, it'll always have designated dealers. Think of, you know, large financial global institutions. As an individual or as a computer science major, or since we are at the blockchain school, there are many students there that can currently build a digital wallet. I think downstream is really where the innovation is going to happen, Philipp. And so what I mean by that is, if I am a developer and I develop a wallet that rides on the Libra blockchain, then as a wallet provider, I can essentially develop to not only accept Libra coins. I can also, you talked about Ethereum, I could also choose as a wallet provider to offer Ethereum as well as Bitcoin, and digital gold, I think, is a great representation of what Bitcoin is. The way we are positioning our payment system is being a regulated one versus some of the others that are either not regulated or the regulation has not caught up yet to what they have developed. And the real big difference between, you talk at the onset, you talk about permission versus permissionless. you know, in talking to regulators over the past 18 months, it was very, very clear to them that they wanted us to have a postal address. You know, Satoshi Nakamoto, we just celebrated 12 years, and I'm amazed, Philipp, that you managed to post on LinkedIn while running the conference. I don't know how you multitask that way. I certainly couldn't do it. But it is clear that, you know, regulators have told us that they want a postal address, they want a certain organization, they want us to be regulated, and we are following that particular pathway. So I really don't think it's competing. I really, really think it's complementary, and is yet again giving consumers the option of who they want to go for. And the question I'll have to you and to the audience today is, if you take your traditional banking right now, how easy is it for you to close down your account, for example, Deutsche Bank, and open up an account at another bank? It is quite difficult. However, your money in one bank is the exact same money as in the other bank. And so that's where this interoperability comes into play, and optionality is extremely important for a consumer and their choice of leveraging whichever payment rails they want.
Okay, I have two more questions, and then we have the next speaker coming. Very often you get the question, for example, journalists are of course having this question, why should we write an article about a digital euro and payment of the future? Because the readers, which are human beings in Germany, they don't have a benefit of it. You know, they use the Apple Pay stuff, this works, they use the IBAN code, so why should they actually write about something where the people who are reading the article will not have a benefit? So there is nobody who probably is interested, because people in reading magazines are not necessarily the decision makers in companies, right? And this then leads to another perspective, saying that my personal opinion is, and I would like to ask if you agree, my personal opinion is that euro on blockchain systems, that's what you are doing, is mainly makes extremely much sense for financial inclusion. You said this is basically related to remittances, right? Then the second domain is the machine economy, which is extremely small right now, but will grow, and the area of tokenization, because then you have multiple tokens, you can swap and trade these tokens, all assets sitting on one platform. So that's the domains where I think money on blockchain makes the most sense: financial inclusion, tokenization and settlement of assets, and machine economy. And what is missing here? The private individual retail person in Germany, right? That's not in the list. Would you agree that these are the three key domains which are also a little bit out of our scope, right? Financial inclusion is far away geographically. Machine economy is far away time-wise, and tokenization is also still a couple of years ago in a broad field. Would you agree with this judgment? Because this makes it difficult to really explain what is the benefit of your platform for local citizens, for example.
Yeah, so it's a very good point. One, Philipp, we have to remember that CBDCs are being developed both at the wholesale and at the retail level. And so that's important to know. I'm a firm believer that if CBDCs develop at the retail level, it'll put downward pressure on regional banks. Therefore, I haven't yet seen enough to believe that that is the path forward. The benefit for a retail consumer, for example, one of the students today, using Libra, is the following. One, you know that it will cost either you or the merchant much less than it currently costs. And I think that's important to note, Philipp, because going back to my example with buying my bed this week, where the manager essentially said, I would give you 2% off if you had a way of paying and I didn't have to pay transaction costs. I think it's actually a boost to the GDP. And you're right, you can keep using your Apple Pay or Samsung Pay. A digital payment system like ours clearly has in its sights, and you talked about it, financial inclusion and remittances. So that is clearly the first business case. However, we can think of a lot of other business cases in the future, whether it was going into the insurance business, whether it was going to the last mile efforts. One of the reasons why we have 27 members of the association, a handful of them are social impact partners, is that we believe that having a low cost to near no cost a peer-to-peer transaction type of digital payment system is something that the world currently does not have. And Philipp, the question to you and your audience would be, have you tried to send money internationally, whether it was to your kids that were going to school or it was in a remittance type of world? And there are many individuals that are in Germany that are, for example, driving Uber cabs and sending micropayments back. And on average, when it costs you 7%, some corridors, for example, the German to Turkey corridor, if you look at the price of remittance there, it's extremely high. So again, it's one more optionality. If people want to keep paying in cash, like in Germany, a lot of cash is still being used, whereas in the Nordics, for example, less cash, they should have an option.
Absolutely fine. I agree. And two closing remarks. It's indeed as follows. We have students from China here, and this works as follows. The parents of the Chinese students, they first send the money, and then the student sits in the plane, and the person, the student, is arriving before the money, even if the money has been sent previously. So the money is traveling around the world longer than the student sitting in the airplane. I know that's not just the payment rails, that's KYC procedures and all kinds of other things, but still it shows exactly what you mentioned. And the second and the last remark would be, you're right, I think if we are using Apple Pay and Google Pay, we should not forget that somebody is paying for this, that's the merchant, and he probably pays, as you said, 0.5 to 2% at least.